And welcome to our Christmas Eve service. I can't believe I'm saying Christmas Eve, but I hope you'll enjoy the service today. And if you're with us for the first time, I hope you will enjoy being with us. And at the end of the service, there is tea and coffees if you'd like to join us and have a chat. I do have an announcement to make, and it's regarding June Marsh, who was a member of this church for a long, long time. Many of you remember Edwin and June March and the many things they did with us, Wesley Guild music before services and just being there. After Edwin died, June went to live in Newark to be near her daughter Carol and Martin. Sadly, June died last Thursday at the age of 94, a long, happy life. She has chosen to have her funeral at Brancott Crematorium on 19th January, and Carol wishes anyone who wishes to attend, just come along. Carol is here to extend the welcome in person and share in our service. Welcome to Carol and Martin. Good to see you. I do remember Edwin, actually, when I was first here, every Sunday morning, he started off with singing before the service started. So I remember him doing very well. Well, time to hand over to Martin, who's leading our service, and I'm sorry. Yes, well, I will be handing over to Martin then too in a bit. But before we do that, we were singing the Advent hymn 166, and we're singing verses 1 and 4. Jesus, light of the world, hold us.
Come, Lord Jesus, come.
Morning, everyone. Beautiful gravelly voice. I've been practicing all week. We continue to worship God by singing number 175, Light of the World, You Stepped Down into Darkness, Opened My Eyes. Let me see.
Thank you.
I ought to have said, Happy Christmas Eve, everyone. Happy Christmas Eve, everyone.
Happy Christmas
Eve. Let's come before God in prayer. Let us pray. Loving Heavenly Father, we gather today to give you thanks for your Christmas gift to us. We give thanks as Mary's labour pains intensify, heralding Jesus' birth, the empty cradle soon to be filled and overflowing with love, a love that touches, convicts, renews and blesses. We thank you for the joy that fills us as we wait with bated breath to celebrate our Saviour. We give thanks for your loving glory which comes down this Christmas time. As we gather today, this Christmas Eve, help us to look beyond the familiar, to find something new in the ancient stable story. Help us to see the real people in the nativity scene, people full of hopes and fears, filled with questions and uncertainties, experiencing joy and pain. People who loved you, listened to you and took risks for you. People like us. Father God, you're faithful and true, full of power and mercy. You grace the world with salvation, the gift of your Son, who we eagerly await. Your Holy Spirit moves among us, filling us with joyful expectation. Your love knows no end. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we lift our hearts to you. Loving Heavenly Father, you chose Mary, a young girl not yet married, to take part in your story. You chose her for one of the greatest acts of obedience ever demanded. You asked her to risk everything. How must she have felt? Stunned, puzzled, scared, terrified? She must have wondered how Joseph would react. He could have refused to marry her. The consequences would not have been pleasant. An unmarried mother, an outcast. Joseph, however, came good. Mary agreed to your will, and God, before God, knowing that, she put her whole life in your hands. Yes, she had total trust in you. God, your call on our lives will never be as great as that of Mary, mother of our Lord and Saviour. Yet still we may hesitate, have doubts and questions, question the consequences, and perhaps think the risk is too great to follow through. Forgive our lack of trust, our doubts and our fears. Help us to be like Mary, open to you, wholly obedient, and trusting in all things. Let it be as you will. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Okay, good morning, church.
Good morning.
Good to see so many of you here this morning. Before we have the kids' church here now. A few years ago, a phrase became stuck in my mind because during Holy Week, we had some services, messy church services, for parents and toddlers to come along to. And I just said a very flippant, off-the-cuff remark, like, the baby in the cradle becomes the man on the cross. And one of the parents said, oh yes. And they hadn't made the connection. They honestly hadn't made the connection between the baby in the cradle, who they celebrate, and the man on the cross. And Christmas reminds us that God is with us in a very tangible way. It can be hectic, it can be last minute, It can be expensive, but we mustn't forget the important things, that it is a gift, and we're celebrating a gift, and it's a gift to be enjoyed. It's a gift that we need to say thank you for, and it's a gift that we need to consider the implications of Emmanuel, God with us. We're never alone. God with us and God saves us. That's what Jesus means. Now, for most of the world, Christmas is like this. It's like someone giving me a little present. And my reaction will be, wow, isn't it beautiful? Isn't it beautiful? I know, I would put it on the shelf. And I will look at it. Maybe once a year, I'll take it down and dust it off. And I may give thought to the person who gave it me. After a little while, I may even have forgotten who gave it me. But it's there, on the shelf, this lovely, beautiful present. And that is what Jesus is to a lot of people. Something that we talked about a long time ago, something that is on the shelf, something that is there, and maybe occasionally we'll remember. It's lovely, that present, isn't it? Yeah? But what's the reality? What am I supposed to do with the present? Do you think so? But it's so lovely, it's so beautiful. Yeah? And it's holding down the paper on my desk as well. It's a nice paperweight. Well, why would I want to open it? Because you opened this for me. No, you don't have to. Can you open that for me?
You've done a great job there. Thank you. Thank you.
If we took the time to get into the present, then we'd see that there's an even greater present inside. Yeah? These have expired. I'm sorry, we can't. Okay, so I have to take them home with me. But if we took the time to open the present, and to get into the present, to get to know what's inside this gift, this very nice, precious gift that we've been given, we might find something even greater. And that's what we need to do with Jesus and with Christmas. The baby in the cradle becomes the man on the cross. And that has amazing significance for us. So when you're opening your presents and everything at Christmas, think of these out-of-date chocolates. Okay. Okay. Are they going out? Do you want to take these with you? Yeah. I'm just looking up to the waistline of these people here. Okay. So can we say a blessing for them? The one that I usually use in the past is where we say to them, the Lord be with you. And they reply, and also with you. And we say, go in peace. Okay? So together, the Lord
be with you. And also with you.
Go
in peace.
Have a great time. And we're going to sing our next carol, which is Silent Night.
but maybe not. Get to the Maltesers later. Silent night, holy night. And ponder and wonder on the greatest gift that this planet will ever know, we offer to you our praise and our wonder and our thanks. And one way that we can do that is by offering you this money, whether it be here in this pouch or in so many other ways that we give. And we pray that as we rest it before the crib, that you will indeed take it and bless it and use it for your glory's sake. Amen. Now we're going to have a reading from God's word, please.
Mary has an encounter with a heavenly visitor who brings unsettling news. The conversation that follows launches Mary into life-changing decisions, which she accepts willingly. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, favoured one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favour with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Mary said to the angel, How can this be, since I am a virgin? The angel said to her, The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her, who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God. Then Mary said, Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word. Then the angel departed from her.
Thank you, and following on from that, we sing number 187, The Angel Gabriel from Heaven Came, His wings as drifted snow, His eyes as flame.
Mary said, Here am I, the Lord's servant, risking everything for God. If I got a pound for every time someone said they were not good enough to go to church, or they were not good enough to hold office in the church, then I would be very happy. There actually seem to be many millions of people out there within the church and outside the church who are waiting until they're good enough before they enter into a dialogue or a relationship with God. If Christmas teaches us anything, if the incarnation means anything, if the name Emmanuel means anything, then it has very little to do with us and what we do. Where does it say in the Christmas story that when the time was right, when the people of the world had turned to God wholeheartedly, when they had become obedient to God's will, when they'd learned to live in harmony with each other and with their God, in love, in peace, then God sent his Son. Where does it say that? Where does it say that after Mary had got a job, proved her worth, practiced her maternal skills, then God chose her to be the mother of this most important and precious gift? Where does it say that only after the shepherds had repented, pledged lifetime commitment and obedience to God, and promised to undertake theological training, only then were they allowed to come into the presence of the Son of God and offer worship? Where does it say that the three kings, having been given a sign that God was powerfully at work in a baby, born many miles away in a foreign country, where does it say that they had to abandon their culture, abandon their histories and their traditions before they can come and offer homage to the Christ child? Where does it say that we need to be good enough before God will consider calling us his children, before Christ calls us his disciples? Where? Mary wasn't good enough. Joseph wasn't good enough. Israel wasn't good enough. But God was. And he invites us this Christmas to take advantage of his goodness in the gift of Christ. Yes, there will be neighbors who will see us as hypocritical when we lose our tempers with them one day on a Friday, often for very good reasons, and then they see us going to church on Sunday. They'll probably see us as hypocrites. They will find it incomprehensible when a murderer goes to prison and comes out 10 or 20 years later preaching the gospel. It won't make any sense to them at all. And we, what are we going to do when these things happen? What will be our response? Are we and will we be bold enough to say, hallelujah, it's all because of Jesus Christ, it's all because of Christmas? It started with God doing a very, very foolish thing, taking a risk. When his people wanted to move away to greener pastures, when they wanted to get out of their hellhole on earth, when they prayed to God to be rescued, to be set free from their oppression, whether it be Rome the religious laws, or even their sins. When they prayed to be rescued from their oppression, God heard them and did a foolish thing. He joined them. Not just asking a young girl to risk all for his sake, but risking his purpose in the shape of a very vulnerable baby. How foolish was that? And yet, we are forever grateful for that initiative. So this Christmas, we know the phrases that we will be saying and singing. Emmanuel, God with us, peace on earth, fear not, glad tidings of great joy. At Christmas, and in the wisdom of Christ, God adds another dimension to our faith, and it's this. God often answers our prayers, prayers prayed in distress, not necessarily by removing the cause of our distress, or removing us from the cause of our distress, but by coming to be with us in our distress, in our sinfulness. This is what incarnation means. This is Christmas. This is why it's happy in every sense of being blessed. So, happy Christmas to you all. Have a great season as of tomorrow. And remember, especially to our PA technicians there, remember that it's not just one day. And you don't have to do all the drinking and the eating on one day. It's actually 12 days. 6th of January, you know. Yeah. And if on the 6th of January you want to convert to being an Orthodox, then Christmas starts all over again for you. Okay, so do remember that and enjoy. Enjoy this amazing gift. Amen. Or hymn 210, Love Came Down at Christmas.
To those who've been praying for my grandson. He has epilepsy and was quite ill, but they've changed his medication. And so far, the last 3 weeks, he's had no more thoughts. So very grateful for your prayers. Thank you.
That's wonderful. Bless you, Paul. Thank you. Behind you.
He's behind you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Well, I'd like to thank you for this year. It's been a bit traumatic because I've got a sister that's been in hospital in Derby Royal for months, and she had a heart transplant 20 years ago and it began to fail. And I remember quite earlier on telling you about this. Well, she has now been to Glenfield and recently had another transplant, which has been successful, and they've kept it going. She was in hospitalised for months, and it's been a success. She's now home, and she's like a new woman. Oh, so thank you all.
Bless you, Pat. Thank you. Thank you. You've got more sweeties, Tony.
Not for you, no.
Can't get the ministers.
Looking after you. Yeah. Last night, this space was full of the church of Martoma, the Indian church. And it was an amazing experience being here with them for a couple of hours. We'd only got halfway through the program after 2 hours. I want you to pray for them because they are registered with the Churches Together in England, and I would like them to become part of the Churches Together in Woolerton, and they are praying about that, and I'm praying about that, and I would like you to pray for them and with me and for them. Okay. And some of you may have heard, but I think this is a good opportunity to say, my father died yesterday morning, and the family have been by his bedside on and off for the last 3 or 4 weeks, isn't it? Yeah, and he was ready to go, he was happy to go, and he went in his own time. But thank you for your prayers and your support over the past few weeks.
And thank you, Tony, for your ministry and for your message this morning. Love and prayers are with you both, of course, and with your family.
I'd just like to say again to you, thank you for your prayers. David is back in the home now, he's out of hospital. They appear to have got rid of all the infection, but how long that will last, we don't know. So physically he's a lot better, but he's quite unsettled. He's wanting to be in bed, he's wanting to be out of bed, they're not caring for him and all sorts of other things. But I'm hoping that he does settle. Can I have your prayers again for that, please? Thank you.
Thank you. And Sylvia, I think I'd like to say thank you for last week when you organised some of us to go to Southminster to sing with a combined choir, which was wonderful. Same, I couldn't sing, but that's probably an advantage. But bless you for what you did, and for our emergency services who organised the whole thing. Bless you. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to just say some prayers for a friend of mine who's recently had surgery for bowel cancer about 3 weeks ago, and she's just found out she's got secondaries in her lung and liver.
Good. Thank you, Angela.
Hi, you may remember I asked for prayers a few weeks ago for a friend of mine who was waiting for surgery and hadn't got a date. He's now had the surgery and unfortunately had 2 or 3 complications since, but he now seems to be recovering. The pain's under control and he's got lots of antibiotics, so I'd ask you to continue to pray for him and his family, please. I don't have permission to give a username. Okay.
Thank you, Dennis. And I presume that all of the shoeboxes are now being delivered that you were instrumental in from this area. Thank you.
I just thank and praise God that this year, after 2 years of not having Tony at home, that we will be sharing our Christmas Day tomorrow together and celebrating the birth of Christ. But thank you all for your love, care and prayers. And we've received actually quite a few blessings this week, which I thank God for. Thank you.
Bless you, Dorothy. Thank you. Continue to offer this prayer, if I may. O God of all justice and peace, we cry out to you in the midst of the pain and the trauma and violence and fear which prevails in the land where Jesus was born. Be with those who need you in these days of suffering. We pray for people of all faiths, Jews, Muslims, Christians, and for all people of the land. And while we pray to you, Lord, for an end to violence and the establishment of peace, we also call for you to bring justice and equity to the peoples. Guide us into your kingdom, where all people are treated with dignity and honour as your children. For to all of us, you are our loving Heavenly Father. We pray today that you will look down with love upon our church as day by day we struggle to be a body worthy of Jesus' name. Be with us as we focus on the coming of your kingdom and that incredible gift of your Son this Christmas. We pray for those who feel far from themselves and from others. We pray that this Advent season might, in the midst of demand, provide soft nights and ease so that people can return to themselves, knowing you too are always in the heart and always wait for us with kindness and love. We remember today all who have not given their consent, but whose lives and bodies and integrity are taken for granted. For them we pray for justice, reparation and truth. Mary recognized your promise of mercy. Lord, we ask you to show mercy on all who are sick, fearful, or in mourning. Especially we pray for those members of our church family who now we will just remind ourselves of. Paul and Julie's grandson, who is improving. For that sister who has been ill most of this year, but now has had a second heart transplant and is doing so well. We give thanks to the Martin Indian Church that meets here, and that indeed we pray for the future of that church becoming more and more a part of the ecumenical ties there are in this area. And of course we remember Tony's dad, who passed away yesterday. And we think of him and Joe and their wider family, wherever they be in the world, in America, the Caribbean, or wherever. And we give thanks, of course, to David, who's now back in the care home, but is still quite unsettled. So we continue to uphold him and Sylvia in love and prayer. And Angela has shared about a friend who's had surgery for bowel cancer, but now has secondaries. We pray at this moment indeed for all those in the emergency services, those who work in hospitals, from doctors to surgeons to nurses and so on, the whole wide, vast variety of people who feel called to work not only in the National Health Service but in the private sector as well. And of course, Dillis has shared about her friend who's had surgery with one complication but is improving. And with Dorothy, we give thanks for her and for Tony, who is home for Christmas. And they're so thankful for our love and our prayers. Heavenly Father, you sent to earth the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, that in your power and love we might also have the gift of eternal life. Bless those whom we love that have departed this life with the gift of your all-encompassing love and life eternal. Heavenly Father, who chose Mary to be the mother of the promised Saviour, fill us, your servants, with your grace, that in all things we may embrace your holy will, and with her rejoice in your salvation. Send us out to finish our Advent journey, filled with love, with joy and peace, ready to receive the promise afresh into our lives. And today we remember that God surprised us by coming among us through the yes of Mary. Let us always be open to the surprise of finding God in unexpected places. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake and in the name of your Son, our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And it seems a very fitting hymn to finish, thinking about God surprising Mary and all of us. He's saying, who would think that what was needed to transform and save the earth might not be a plan or army, proud in purpose, proved in worth. We sing.
Just a reminder that we have a Christingle service here at 4 o'clock this afternoon. Please come and join us if you would like. And a service here tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. Okay, so I think that will be an all-age worship or children-friendly service. So please join us. A blessing. Lord, if you want me to follow you, guide me. If you want me to speak in your name, inspire me. If you want me to show your love, love me. If you want me to worship you, fill me with your spirit. Lord, if this is what you want, I want it too. Mary said, "Here I am, the Lord's servant. Let it be as you have said." And so may God bless us, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.